In the past century, computers have gone from room-sized calculators to smartphones that let me watch a video of the top 10 Angry Birds speedruns of all time while I'm at the airport. But as much as computers have changed, they've also stayed the same, at least in terms of how they do their computing. But in the last few years, scientists have been racing to build a totally new kind of computer called a quantum computer that may spark a revolution. And if you've seen any news about this research, you may have also seen that quantum computers have a distinct look. They look like a complicated stack of gold disks and wires hanging from a ceiling, sort of like a steampunk chandelier. And you may have wondered, why do quantum computers look like that? And we can answer that for you. But the thing is, while they really do look like that, they also kind of don't. Any kind of regular computer, be it the one in your phone or the one in your smart toaster, runs on exactly the same principles. At some level, it's processing information in the form of bits, abstract mathematical objects that are always in one of two states. For convenience, those states are usually labeled 0 and 1. Meanwhile, every computer contains physical objects that can also be in one of two states, usually in the form of electric current either flowing or not flowing. In other words, these objects physically represent those bits. To do the actual computing, the rest of the computer processes bits by switching them between the zero state and the one state as needed. These days, the most advanced microchips can have hundreds of billions of these switches on them, meaning you can fit incredible computing power into a tiny space. Since the 1940s, we've built countless different kinds of computers with this approach. But in recent years, scientists have been trying to build computers using something totally different. As their name suggests, a quantum computer runs on the principles of quantum mechanics, the weird counterintuitive theory that describes the universe on the smallest scales. And the main difference with these computers is that instead of using bits, they use qubits. A qubit is like a regular bit, except that instead of being in either the zero or the one state, it can somehow be in some combination of the two states at once. This is the strange quantum phenomenon known as superposition, and there's nothing like it in the everyday world. It's as if a coin could somehow be in both the heads and tails states at once. It's just kind of odd. We've known about the kinds of quantum systems that produce qubits for a century now, and in recent decades, people have learned that qubits can process information very differently from regular bits. This is due to that superposition, as well as other quantum phenomena like entanglement and interference, which are super complicated in their own right, so we'll set them aside for this episode. What it all comes down to is this. The extra possible states that a qubit can be in, those different 0 and 1 states, can interact in totally different ways with each other than your regular 0 and 1 states. Researchers can exploit these effects to do clever tricks, and sometimes it means a quantum computer winds up performing a specific computing task much faster than a classical computer. So recently, a sort of arms race has begun between universities, big tech companies, small startups, and even militaries to build working quantum computers and discover new uses for them. It's a big industry with a lot of hype. In June 2025, one quantum company bought out a rival for just over $1 billion. And that's downright wild, given that basically, not a single quantum computer has made it out of the prototype stage, and none are actually being used right now to do computations that a classical computer can't do. The biggest challenge in making quantum computers is something called decoherence, a physical process that makes quantum objects lose their quantumness. When a qubit decoheres, it goes from being in some kind of superposition state to a regular old 0 or 1 bit, and once that's happened, it's almost impossible to change it back. And what causes decoherence? Well, a better question would be, what doesn't cause decoherence? Quantum systems are notoriously sensitive. Basically, anything causes them to decohere, getting hit by a single particle of radiation, air molecules bumping into them, or their surroundings getting too hot. And by too hot, I mean they can decohere if they get hotter than the deepest depths of outer space. So the quantum objects that people actually study in labs tend to be on the scale of individual atoms, or at most, small molecules. Any bigger, and it's far more more likely to decohere. This is also why we don't see weird quantum effects like heads and tails coins in everyday life. At human scales, decoherence washes away all quantum effects in ludicrously short times. Making a quantum computer is an endless fight against decoherence. It takes a lot of work to both get enough qubits together and keep them stable enough to be used in computation. Remember how modern microchips can have billions of bits on them? Well, right now, the most advanced quantum computers have about 1,000 qubits, and they're extremely unreliable. Now, this sensitivity can vary, depending on what you're using to make your qubits. This is a new field, so researchers are trying to figure out what works best. But the current leaders in the quantum computing race use a superconducting qubit. These are micrometer-scale chunks of silicon made using techniques borrowed from the regular microchip industry. And a micrometer is huge in the world of quantum mechanics. So given their relative size, these superconducting qubits are a lot easier to manipulate in a lab than qubits made of individual atoms. But as you might suspect, there's a trade-off. They're also way more sensitive to things that can make them decohere. So to keep them functioning properly, they need to be kept unimaginably cold. Which finally brings us back to our original question. Why do quantum computers look like that? It's not wrong to say that some quantum computers do in fact look like funky chandeliers, but there's some nuance here, because that huge chandelier-like device isn't actually the quantum computer itself. After all, if a qubit is a microscopic piece of silicon, it only needs a microchip-sized platform to stand on. So the actual quantum computer is just one chip, small enough to fit in the palm of your hand. Meanwhile, the giant chandelier is the cooling device. It's called a dilution refrigerator, and it can make some of the coldest places in the universe. The technology behind it is actually more than 60 years old, and while there's a bunch of research being done to improve these things, many labs use off-the-shelf versions. So, yeah, if you got a spare $1 million lying around, you too can impress your friends with your very own dilution refrigerator. But despite being off the shelf, it uses some pretty neat physics to do its job. In order to pump heat out of the working area, a dilution refrigerator cycles between mixing and unmixing two different isotopes of liquid helium, both of which are only about 4 degrees warmer than absolute zero. The first isotope is your run-of-the-mill helium-4, with two protons and two neutrons in its nucleus. The second is helium-3, which only has one neutron. The actual cooling process relies on one of many quantum mechanical quirks that kick in at such low temperatures. Basically, when you mix these two liquids together, they wind up absorbing a lot of heat from the stuff around them, including the stuff that can cause a quantum computer to stop working correctly. So by repeatedly mixing and unmixing these helium liquids, you can continue to pull in heat and keep your computer cold. As for that tiered chandelier-y shape, with each layer you get more cooling. The top layer is pretty close to room temperature, but the bottom layer is just a fraction of a degree above absolute zero. So that's where you put the quantum chip. Meanwhile, all the wires you see sticking out of things are there to control input and output signals to and from the qubits, to actually do computations. Now, technically, not every kind of quantum computer needs a dilution refrigerator. Some, for instance, are based on photons, particles of light, and don't need this sort of cooling. So not every quantum computer actually does look like an expensive chandelier, and scientists may eventually develop the technology in such a way that these huge coolers aren't really necessary anymore. But right now, even with all this cooling, qubits are still super prone to decoherence. If you want even more jargon from the quantum computing community, many people say that we're now in the noisy, intermediate-scale quantum era, or the NISQ era. That means we can get enough qubits together to do some things we want, that's the intermediate-scale part of the name, but we haven't fully tamed the decoherence effects, that's the noisy part. The era beyond that is where quantum computers could have many more uses outside research labs. It may only come when we have tens of thousands of qubits, roughly 10 times more than we can currently manage, and relatively decoherence-free. However, some experts say that that's an underestimate, and only once we hit the million qubit era can we actually do interesting stuff outside the lab, like maybe designing new medicines by searching huge arrays of molecule combinations super quickly, or making more efficient, advanced versions of artificial intelligence. But as exciting as that potential future may sound, before we wrap up, I should offer a word of caution. There's a lot of hype around quantum computers these days, with countless startups trying to sell their products as the vanguard of a quantum revolution. But right now, we simply don't know for sure how useful quantum computers will be in the future. For one thing, there's still a lot we don't understand about regular classical computing. In recent years, there have been several instances where companies claim to have solved a problem using a quantum computer that would have taken a classical computer thousands of years. But every time, other researchers quickly showed that the problem could be solved classically in a much shorter time. So it actually could be done on a regular supercomputer, or even a laptop. And that's kind of a cool result. It proves that research into quantum computers can help us learn how to make classical computers work better. Also, designing quantum algorithms is notoriously hard. And if you want to actually use or sell that algorithm, you also need to prove that a classical computer couldn't do it better or cheaper. Very few cases have been proven to have this so-called quantum advantage. So while it may be true that quantum advantage will revolutionize whole areas of science, commerce, the economy, security, and more, it may also be the case that quantum computers will be worth the effort for only a handful of individual, highly specific use cases in some industries and scientific research fields. So be very skeptical of anyone who tells you quantum computers will change everything, or that they're right around the corner. But despite the caution, there's still cause for lots of excitement in the near future of quantum computing, with countless researchers across the world exploring all the avenues in this emerging technology. And one day, maybe you could hold a quantum computer in the palm of your hand, without it also being stuck to the bottom of a giant refrigerator. Although you probably won't be using it to speedrun Angry Birds at the airport.